Good evening. Thanks for coming out this evening again. And first of all, we'd like to thank Carol J. Miossi for giving us the monies to make all of these events possible every semester. And so this is, again, a chance for us to... All right? So we want to thank Carol J. Miossi one more time. But I just want to give a little introduction. When I was staging the shows for this semester, before we handed everything off to Emma, I had a lucky chance to work with Sherry Simons back in last century, back in 1998. She came in request to do the sound show for us. So I always loved her work, and I always wanted a chance to bring her back. So that was the great thing about being able to curate a few shows over the last 3 years, is I got to bring in people who I really admired as artists. And Sherry was one of my faves. So it really started with her, again, taking on the project and then giving me a little outline of what she really liked to do, bring some friends that she was working with. And once I read that little outline, I knew exactly I wanted that. It's a great interdisciplinary show and one that I hope that we can bring in more students from across campus so that they can, again, take advantage of how the arts kind of weave their way through all the other disciplines. So I want to thank them all for, again, coming out this evening. And I want to thank Emma and Jules and Dennis and all of those who put all that work in. This girl has been working her fanny out. So I'll pass it over.
So he said all my thank yous for me. So that's not fair, but I put this picture here because this is how the gallery looked on Monday. So it's really a feat to pull this stuff off, and it is really a group effort. So it's all the people he mentioned, Jules, Dennis, David does so much, Nancy, Magnolia.
You go louder, Emma?
Oh, yes. My volume. Is that better?
Yeah.
Louder? Okay. And yeah, it's really amazing to pull this stuff off. And again, Miossi is how it happens. And so we're very grateful. And this has been by far the most involved installation I've done here at Cuesta. And it's really amazing to have all of you here with us. It makes it all worth it. I want to call your attention to this. The board, because on February 4th, downtown, is that downtown? Meadow Park Meeting Room. We've been doing these R21 screenings about once a month. And this one's really special because one of the artists from the episode is coming to San Luis to give a little artist talk after. So mark your calendars, be there at 7 to 9. I haven't had time with installation to do a flyer, so check Facebook and be aware. It's going to be really great. We will have time for questions at the end of this, so think of interesting things and write them down and ask them organically, inorganically. I'm going to introduce Byron and then let them go from there. So, Byron Wolf is the project director for the Vanish Show. He's a professor and program director for photography at the Tyler School of Art at Temple University in Philadelphia. His work has been exhibited and published nationally and internationally, and it is included in over 20 museum collections worldwide. He is a recipient of the Santa Fe Prize for Photography and the author of Every Day, a Year-Long Photo Diary. He's a Guggenheim Fellow and a former Lantis University professor at Cal State Chico. And you can take it from here.
Okay, thank you, Emma. Can everybody hear me okay?
Yeah.
Okay. Am I going to formally introduce everybody with their titles and everything?
You don't have to, but I have a cheat sheet.
I need a cheat sheet for that, sort of. Okay. Well, thank you, everybody, for coming. And I want to thank Emma in particular for all of her hard work on this show. I'm sure she had no idea what she was in for when she was handed this exhibition, because this is a long-term ongoing project that has been hard for all of us up here to keep our heads wrapped around for its entirety because of its complexity. This is the first physical manifestation of the show, and to get something from these abstract ideas into something tangible is no easy task, and Emma was very instrumental in sort of making sure we kind of moved along and did what we needed to do. My goal here is in the next about 15 minutes to give you a very brief thumbnail sketch overview of what the Vanish Project is. And one by one, I'm going to introduce some of the collaborators in this project and have them talk a little bit about various facets of the work itself. I want to start with this photograph, which is in many ways how the Vanish Project started. This is a crumpled, roughed up piece of paper that contains that shows a photograph of Lassen Peak, a volcano in Northern California. And this is a copy of a photograph by a 19th century photographer named Carlton Watkins. He made this photograph in about 1870. I have a history of working with old historic archival photographs and landscape photographs in particular, and tracking them down and figuring out where they were made and making new photographs that somehow incorporate or respond to them. And this photograph in particular I started looking for, or the site I started looking for, in about 2005. It took me actually a couple of years to find it. I had to use Google Earth and look at snow patterns to figure out where it was. I went to this site. It was incredibly difficult and laborious. I had friends with me, colleagues helping me. It was about a 4-hour hike into this. We had to do it 4 times before the weather cooperated and I could make a photograph. And at the end of one successful trip, one of my friends asked me, you know, this is really fun and this is really interesting, Byron, but what are you going to do with this? And I kind of shrugged my shoulders and I said, I don't know. At that point, I had been doing this kind of stuff for about 15 years, and it usually went somewhere interesting. This was about 2009 at this point, and this is a re-photograph of Mount Lassen in eruption, made about 100 years, almost to the day after it had erupted. There's a little detail in this picture that I need to point out, and it's right there. That is Rachel Teasdale. She's a geologist, and she is part of this collaboration. And that rock right there is a rock right there where my hat is resting. And anyway, to get back to how Vanish started, I had been thinking about a variety of sites around the Chico, Northern California area that were kind of topical and interesting to me. And Ishii was one of them. If you don't know Ishii, he was a Native American that lived in Northern California. He was the last of the Yahi, as the saying goes, and in 1911 he emerged from the wilderness and came into civilization. And there was a book that was published, the one that you're seeing right here. Anyway, there was this whole series of topics that were really interesting to me because they were very much about this idea of loss. And when I was in graduate school for photography, one of my instructors read a poem to me by Robert Haas, and the opening line says, "All of our new thinking is about loss. In this, it resembles all the old thinking." And that was one of those things that just sort of stuck in my brain, and I kept thinking about it and thinking about it and thinking about it. And these various sites and ideas that I was interested in, none of them existed anymore. Ishii was gone, and a number of other things were gone. And I realized that these were topics and ideas that were so rich and so complex that in order to explore them in any significant way, I needed to do it with other people. And so I knew Troy Jollimore there, only by name, really, I think. We worked at the same university, and I sent him an email. And we met for coffee, and I described this harebrained project that I had hallucinated at some point about trying to respond to things that had vanished. And I actually quoted the line of this poem to him as something that had been in my brain. And so somehow I convinced Troy to be a conspirator in trying to do something that responded to Ishii. So I'm going to hand it off to Troy now while we look at a few pictures of Ishii.
Great. Will it reach?
Yeah.
Reach is great. So
as Byron is describing it, you're already getting a sense, I think, of one aspect of the project which appealed to me early on, and I think maybe appealed to all of us when we first got involved and as it proceeded, which was it was very vague, and it was very open and very flexible. It was not in any way a project proposal where Byron said, or any of us at any point said, here's what it'll look like in the end. In fact, it was much more about a kind of a thinking process. And I don't know that looking back, that is why I said yes to it. It just seems so interesting in that respect. I had no idea where it was going. If you're familiar at all with the story of Ishii, you probably already you can guess why that would have seemed one of the appropriate topics for us. There's so much loss involved and so much melancholy, nostalgia, and symbolism, it wrapped up in a Northern California context, involved in this story. And I think the weight of that symbolism has perhaps over the years become so heavy that there are ways in which the individual Ishii almost gets lost. And this was a real human being who existed. And I think part of the thought that I had early on was just it would be nice to be able to see him again or make some kind of contact with this actual person. And part of the project, since Byron is a reef photographer, one of the first things he described that he wanted to do involved a backpacking trip, less arduous than the one you just talked about, but nonetheless a little tough, it was not easy, to Deer Creek, where Ishii used to hang out, and where some of the photos, which were up a few minutes ago and contained in this book, this is actually from the site that we backpacked to, those photos were taken on this trip after Ishii had come out, about 4 years after he had walked out of the woods, as Byron said, and had been living in the Bay Area, and basically, dressing like a city dweller, and he ate ice cream, and then sort of, really assimilated in a lot of ways culturally. His friends, who were anthropologists, wanted to go back to the place where he used to hang out in the wild, have him dress in a loincloth again, hold the spear, go swimming, right, demonstrate the stuff he used to do, take pictures of it. And he was resistant. He didn't want to go back there. And he was resistant for a number of reasons, partly having to do with sort of respect for the ancestors and so on, partly because, he really liked his new life. But in the end, they talked him into it, and they went back and they took these photos. And these photos are such interesting artifacts because, they became very famous, and they really formed people's images, visually speaking, of Ishii and who he was. And obviously, they were very staged. I want to stop a little short before using the word fake, but there's something very fake about them in a sense. They dressed him up like he used to dress up, and they had him do this stuff, but there is something very staged about them, and there was a lot of effort going into the concealing of the staging. And so I thought this idea of Byron's, this desire to go back to the actual place where they were taken, to re-photograph these spots, to get as close as we could, actually to them, as a way of investigating and getting us to think about what's involved in these processes of staging and of just of interpretation, of thinking about photographs. And maybe, taking that level, those layers of symbolism that have come to rest on those photographs and on Ishii himself, and thinking our way through them, or maybe just, re-symbolizing, connecting them in different ways, thinking about them in new, fresh ways. It seemed like a fascinating project to me, so I wanted to be part of it. And I was really happy with how that all turned out.
Thanks. And then at some point, Troy said, I know someone who is really interested in this story of Ishii, and would you mind if she participated in our conversations? And the way we started as a group was for about a semester or a year, I can't even remember now, we met and we held regular meetings to talk about this project. And Heather began participating, and she has a background in anthropology and creative writing, and it was very evident early on that she was an important voice in this project in providing a kind of connective tissue between the different ideas that we were exploring. So I'm going to hand this off to Heather, and she has one of the poems about Ishii, or about the journey to discover Ishii, that she's going to read.
Thank you for having us. It's so great to be somewhere different, Rainy. It's been raining. It's been raining in Chico for, I don't know, we have like 55 inches of rain. So, as Sherry said, we're happy just to be somewhere different. differently raining. So as Byron said, I have a bit of a background in anthropology. My mother was an anthropologist who had actually taken a class from Theodora Kroeber at UCLA years and years ago, and she talked about Ishi constantly when I was growing up. And my brother became an anthropologist, and I went to Columbia and did a degree in anthropology. And at some point, when I was trying to decide if I was going to go on and do a PhD, kind of very much in the last semester of my studies, anthropology just became too sad for me. It felt like the place where you went to study things that were disappearing. And I couldn't do it anymore. And so I sort of gave up that part of myself and pursued writing more seriously. And Byron mentioned also that in some ways I've been able to work through the connective tissue. And I guess one of the things that has connected all of these subjects, especially Ishi and the Hooker Oak and the Mammoth, is this study of melancholy, this study of loss, or this study of disappearance, or something that you can't get back to. And in fact, I was thinking, as I was trying to think of something interesting to say, I was thinking about one of the last lines of a very wonderful novel. It's someone's first novel. His name is Frederick Ryken. And the book is called The Odyssey, a play, of course, on the Odyssey. And one of the last lines in the book is, who in this world would give up a chance to see the other side of everything? And that's always been such an enchanting idea for me. And so in some ways, this has been my way of trying to see the other side of everything. So I was asked to read. So the primary contributions I've made to the project have been poems, although I did write an essay about the Mammoth with Sherry's help, and it was really fun. This poem is about a real person who lived until, I guess, the early 90s in Red Bluff. And he was, I'm not exactly sure which tribe he had come from, but this had been documented in some early texts that when the white settlers were, you know, infiltrating these tribes, they kidnapped women often and took them. And they had taken these two women hostage, and at some point in the middle of the night, the women disappeared, and they didn't know where they had gone. And then they heard screaming, and they went down. It was in the middle of a huge sort of an ice, snow, sleet storm. And they followed the screaming, and they went down to the creek, and one of the women, unbeknownst to these men who had kidnapped them, was pregnant and given birth, and they were ceremonially dipping the baby into the raging creek. So it's called Snowdrop. When he blinked forth from the call into the pitchy blackness of the storm, they took him and hurled him over and over into the raging creek, dipping his screams into the current where even the salmon tumbled in sleep and birds quivered in their damp nests. The first lip of his world was this crash, and his heart caught hold of a rock and stayed there, laced with ice. They called him Snowdrop, like the purple runt that edges its way out of mud in March, like the icicles that formed on his toes as they pulled him, finally, from the water, frosted and screaming, a trinket glinting with all the bright new terror that had passed, and what was, of course, to come.
The next topic that emerged and vanished came about because I was reading the morning paper in about 2000, and there was a little tiny article in the paper about a mammoth's molar that had been discovered in a ditch in the municipal park. And I wasn't that familiar with Chico yet. We had just moved there. But I knew it well enough to know that mammoths weren't seen around those parts very often. And I started trying to imagine, well, where was that? And I was trying to picture it in the parts of the park that I knew, and I'm like, a mammoth. And I was trying to imagine what a mammoth would look like if we saw it in the park. And, well, they just found the molar. Where's the rest of the mammoth? And, how was it oriented when they found it? Was the mammoth, upside down, or was it sideways? And that was another one of those things that sort of stuck in my head for a long time. And then, it was 10 years later, I think, I realized that it was sort of part of this bigger topic of things that had vanished. And I thought, well, wouldn't it be interesting to try to do something that responds to the mammoth that was found, 2 miles from my house? And that's when I started to think, it would be really interesting to have somebody like a sculptor involved who could make something physical out of just this pure idea. And so that's when Sherry Simons got involved. We had worked together just a little bit at Chico, and I had seen enough of her work and thought that we would have a pretty interesting chemistry of working together. And so I asked Sherry to be involved in a sense, reimagine what the Colombian mammoth might have looked like, what it might have been. And that started a kind of investigation to learn more about the tooth. And just to give you a little bit of insight into it, it was a tooth that was discovered by a geologist. He recovered it, took it back to the lab, and students at the university were cleaning it, and as they were cleaning it, it basically disintegrated on the table. And so the vanished mammoth's tooth, which existed, had vanished. And so we didn't have it anymore. This is a picture of Sherry in the ditch where it was found. And with that, I'm going to hand it off to Sherry.
Thank you. I want to also take the opportunity to say how grateful we are to be here and how special this campus is and the people that are here. It's really remarkable. You guys are so on it. So one of the things that I found out after Byron was talking about the vanished tooth, when we didn't find this out for a little while thereafter, was that not only had it vanished, or kind of disintegrated when the students were cleaning it, but the instructor, who will remain unnamed, thought, well, this is kind of embarrassing, and he kind of swept it all into a box, a shoebox. And this tooth was probably between 10 and 30,000 years old, and it was exhumed without permission. It could have actually been attached to a jaw. Who knows what other parts of the mammoth were there. And he put it into a shoebox, put the shoebox on a shelf, thinking, I'm going to put this back together someday. And he lost his memory, more or less, and couldn't remember where the box was. And when we went back to the ditch with him to kind of try to stir things up a little, he also couldn't remember where in the ditch the tooth was found. So vanish, vanish, vanish. And that appealed to me a great deal. Byron was talking about kind of re-envisioning a mammoth. And I was interested in that, but also as a pataphysicist. I mean, do you guys know what a pataphysicist is? Okay, so I'm a pataphysicist, which is somebody who is interested in or who practices made-up facts and invented final theories from those made-up facts, So it just fit really well. And you all can be card-carrying pataphysicists if you declare that. It's fine. So what I became interested in is what does a mammoth tooth look like? And I knew nothing about mammoths or mammoth teeth, and so when I went online, Google it, I was shocked at what it looked like. It looked like a monster. Like the whole thing didn't even look like a monster's tooth. It looked like a monster, And I was very sad that this particular tooth was gone. This whole feeling of loss and nostalgia was really hitting me. I made a little website for the tooth, and I asked if anyone who had ever had a dream about a mammoth to contribute drawings of their dream to the website. And one person did, but that's not because she saw the website, it was because I asked her to. So, yeah, we were having kind of conversations about that. But anyway, I began to just tell the story of the vanishing over and over, and to students and to friends, and that kind of caught on a little bit, and other people would start to send me the result of the story, which would be, I asked people, could you please send me what you think a mammoth tooth looks like? Give me scale, size, height, you know, all that stuff, and I'll build it. If you send it to me, I will build your diagram as though it's a blueprint. That's where all the teeth on the tables come from. And I think that there's a kind of, that's real. That's a real fake mammoth tooth.
Pataphysical
tooth. You know, and I believe in the kind of secret life of materials, and that there's a kind of contagion in truth and fiction, and those things kind of, you know, support each other, and it's not always necessary to separate those two things. And if you get enough drawings of a mammoth tooth and enough constructions, then they start to build their own sort of tooth. And so my interest was sort of rematerializing the sad thing of its disappearance. And it's ongoing. And if anybody wants to send a drawing, I would absolutely love it. You can find me at CSU Chico in the directory. But don't cheat. Don't go look at what it looks like. That's no fun. All right.
Yeah, as soon as you know what a mammoth's tooth looks like, you can't unknow it.
And you can buy them on eBay if you really fall in love with them.
So Sherry and I had the opportunity to interview this world-renowned paleontologist. In fact, what happened is I was writing the essay, and I thought, boy, in order for this not to be pataphysically invented, I better get some fact-checking, because the science of the mammoth is not my area of expertise. So Sherry and I were talking, and she came up with the idea. She said, why don't you contact Dr. Daniel Fisher? He is, if you type in Mammoth National Geographic, you will find these short films called, like, Waking the Baby Mammoth, and the mammoth, I can't remember, The Mammoth Cometh, I think, is the next one. and they feature this paleontologist from the University of Michigan who was invited to Siberia. He's done a number of expeditions in Siberia. He evidently even speaks Yakutian, which is the language of the indigenous people in the northeast region of Siberia. And he talked to us about the recovery of this fully intact baby mammoth. They named her Yuba, which means love. And he talked about how they were doing some dissection, this 43,000-year-old mammoth's body. And he told us this story about how he sliced open the pericardium, and he was going to reach in just to feel the size and approximate weight of the baby mammoth. She was 30 days old when she died, her heart. And he said, I had my hand in there, and I was holding her heart. And I realized I was holding this 43,000-year-old mammoth's heart. And I was reaching that far into the past, and he said he was overcome with a sense of awe. And for us, we were all teary in this interview, but I did want to mention that partly because that is the exact gravity that has moved this project, is this sense of having some contact with the past that is real, and not wholly invented, but partially invented, and not idealized, but partially idealized. It's such a fascination, I think, for all of us.
On that note, a kind of sense of awe and a sense of time has been an underlying current to all of this work. The topics that we've been dealing with go back as far as 15 million years old. There have been elements in this project. And I think that both the sense of awe and the sense of trying to expand our sense of going beyond an individual human generation has been a really driving part of this project. So speaking of awe, the last topic that we have been dealing with is the Hooker Oak, which was a famous tree that stood in Chico. It was a valley oak, and it's something that I fell in love with the first time I saw it, but I never saw it in person because it died long before I had a chance to see it. I only knew it through the photographic record. Part of what I do involves looking at in archives and looking at photographs, and in Chico, this tree shows up a lot in the photographic archive. And so I had to start asking, what is this tree? Where is this tree? And it didn't take long to find out that it was the Hooker Oak and that it stood in Chico, and it was revered to be the largest and oldest living tree in the world. It fell in 1977, and when it fell, they were able to determine that it wasn't the oldest living tree in the world. It wasn't 1,000 years, as they suspected. It was more like 226 years. And it was probably two trees that grew together. But that didn't really matter. That didn't really change anything. It was still a sort of incredible spectacle. And there are hundreds and hundreds of photographs of people standing in front of the tree, and people would make trips to the tree to see it. And at the start, I thought this was just going to be an exploration of the historic photographs of the tree. I didn't really have any sense that there was anything contemporary about it. But as I started to investigate and talk to people and try to track down remnants of the tree, I ultimately ran across a newspaper article after the tree fell in 1977 that said that acorns from the tree had been sent to London to be planted at the Royal Botanical Gardens there, because the former director of that museum is the namesake for the Sir Joseph Hooker Oak tree. So I happened to be traveling and was able to route my trip through London, and I tracked down the tree and I found a 50-year-old offspring of the Hooker Oak. And this kind of discovery happens more often than you would expect when you just start looking for things. And I made this photograph of the sort of puny, unhealthy, overly shaded Valley Oak tree in London that's cold and rainy, and Chico is dry and hot in the summer. And I came back, and the local paper, the same paper that published the article about the mammoth's molar, did a story about my trip to photograph the offspring of the Hooker Oak. And then subsequently, about 10 people contacted me with stories about their own offspring of the Hooker Oak. And so that brought us directly into the present, and I made photographs of every known offspring of the Hooker Oak tree. These exist in a large book that's on display in the gallery. And the tree itself was a spectacle. It was massive, and it was almost too big to kind of comprehend how big it was and how old it was. And so everybody laughs when I tell them that it wasn't 1,000 years old, but it was still a really spectacular tree. And so the sixth collaborator, who's not up here with us tonight, is Oliver Hutton, who is a former student of mine and a graphic designer. And so we have been working on trying to create infographics that help explain some of the more unexpected aspects of the tree. Everybody talks about its size, but there are so many other parts to it that are kind of interesting. It was the center of an entire universe, in a sense. It was the center of an ecosystem. We calculated, with the help of Sherry's husband, Paul, who's up here somewhere, we calculated / estimated the total number of acorns that the tree produced was roughly 48 million during the course of its life. But anyway, going back to Heather's comments about the mammoth, there was something driving all of us, I think, about a sense of awe and exploration in all of this. And no matter what we did, no matter where we scratched and dug, we always found something interesting. And I think with that, I'll end it and we'll open it up for
questions
from...
Mm-hmm. Oh, I see that. I'm going to steal
the
question slot.
Because I think in performance, and I have this, as you guys were talking, I have this running list of these performative moments that, to me anyway, really kind of define the whole immersion of how this project emerged. So I'm wondering if you guys can speak to a little bit those, like, the backpacking trips and the collaborations with the drawings and the holding the mammoth's heart. Like, all of these are performances, really, you know? So do you guys want to speak to that?
Pretty mammoth. Yeah, you want to talk about the backpacking trip, Heather?
It was a performance of enduring. The backpacking trip was really, it's kind of interesting. I won't go into great detail about this, but the actual Ishii Wilderness is protected completely, almost in a complete circle by private land, which makes it very difficult to access. And there are two sort of public access points, both of which require, well, one requires a 16-mile hike up a creek bed, which sounded like, you know, between all of us, you know, four or five broken ankles. It didn't seem like a good idea. And then another one is driving down this chute out of the mountains, driving partway and hiking partway, which also sounded, and a lot of mud everywhere, poison oak. It didn't sound like a good idea either. So we actually were able to obtain access to this land through one of the private owners, which made it kind of its own, an adventure in itself, because we got driven in about 13 miles before we even started hiking. We had a guy, someone who had been in this area. His name is Dave Noble, and his family, I think he was fifth generation Chico, fourth or fifth. He's been in Chico, his family's been in Chico forever. He had extensive documentation about Ishii, about Deer Creek, and he acted as sort of a guide, and he took us back in there. And really, it's hard to explain the magical nature of being in this place. It wasn't just that it was so removed and so isolated, which it was. It was this sense, really, of all of these tribes that had existed, the Yana and the Yahi and the Northern Yana, and the everywhere you walked was ancestral land, and yet it was absent of the ancestors. And it was really, I mean, magical sounds positive. It was also very, very, very sad. I mean, and I think part of my impetus to write the poems was to try to live in the sadness a little bit, and that I couldn't think of another way. You use the word performance to sort of perform my way out of this sadness. I don't know. You want to say something about the backpacking trip?
No. Okay. I want to say something about it. It's really interesting that you talk about it in a performative sense, because I think the places that we went to investigate and retrieve information always felt like a kind of stage, mm-hmm. you know. And so, like, when we went to the place, let's say, where the mammoth's tooth was unearthed, it was really a drainage ditch. There's nothing sexy about it, you know? And so we, like, kind of hiked down in there. And the question, I think, that was, now that you're saying this, I kind of remember this thing in my head, which is, what do we do here, you know? And so we had to invent what we did on that stage, you know? Well, here, what we do is we look for shiny things. You know, and we pretend that we're investigators, you know, and we take it real seriously, and we go with what we find. You know, when we went to the site where Ishii walked out of the wilderness, and it's in Oroville. I don't know how many of you have been to Oroville. It's like Chainsaw Massacre town. And I mean, here's this incredible historic moment, and it was marked by a crappy, you know, stone little thing. And we're standing there in awe at the reality of that stage. The stage melted, and it became this real place. But what the question became, now we're actors here, what do we do here? How do we realize what we have to realize? So I like that you put it in a performative. Thank you.
So you guys can ask questions then.
Not more.
Okay, thank you, Emma. I really enjoyed those charcoal drawings that you had in the art gallery. I was wondering if you could tell us more about your process when you made those.
Sure. Can you hear me if I don't use a mic?
No.
Okay. Oh. Yeah. So those, just technically, those are matte. It's a matte film for, it's actually used for laser printing, and it's two-sided, so if you're going to use it, be careful, because one side accepts pigment and the other side, it'll wash off. So those are slices of the mammoth skeleton at a diagonal, and what I was interested in was to obfuscate a little bit more the information about the mammoth. So I wasn't trying to illustrate it, but I was trying to grab the feeling of the massiveness of the animal. So I took diagonal slices but translated them onto a vertical plane. And it's basically a mixture of the soot from the hooker oak tree, which we grated on a little tiny grater in the studio. And so a combo of that and some Sumi ink and some matte medium. And there were a lot of experiments about how much of each, and I had to be, no one was looking, so I had to try to be a little bit honest about how much tree was in there, you know? And they're real trees. So actually once we talked to Daniel Fisher, the paleontologist at the University of Michigan, he asked, well, what are you making for this show? And I explained this, and I had gone to we went to the Museum of Natural History in New York City, and I was so excited to visit this mammoth skeleton with finally a tape measure and lots of pictures. And so I could translate that, but the paleontologist asked what we were doing, and I said, oh, I did it on this diagonal, and I surmised this and this. He goes, yeah, we already have that program, you know. But I was really glad I didn't know about that, because I wanted to find out myself. Does that answer your question? Yeah. And there's a lady in pink right here that has a question.
Okay. Oh, okay. There's someone behind her, though.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Else? More questions?
Have anybody explored where you found that mammoth tooth, thinking maybe it washed down from further places, or, you know, was there any hints that maybe that was a spot that drained out from further up, or I'm just curious about if there is any efforts to continue the hunt.
Oh, yeah. Oh boy, were there ever. Well, actually, Rachel Teasdale and the geologist who found the tooth took us into the ditch and read the sediment and explained to us how old everything is and what is wash and what is rubble as it comes down. And I believe me, I've looked at my notes 10 times and I still can't really exactly figure it out. Is this Tuscan Ridge or whatever it is, you know? And I don't feel that we got a definitive answer about how it could have gotten there, let alone we couldn't find where, you know, even where it was. But I will add one little thing that's interesting. A tooth arrived in a little museum on campus about 10 years after the tooth vanished. A whole mammoth tooth. We visited it, like I won't tell you how big it is. Okay, no, no, I was just kidding here. So, this little mammoth tooth. So it arrived, and for all this time, for 4 years of our project, we never knew anything about it. No one in the museum knew anything about it. It was just a spectacle object. And just after, like last month, we sent photographs of it that Byron had taken, like a million photographs of it, and we sent them to this paleontologist at the University of Michigan, and he wrote back, yes, it's a male, it's a Colombian mammoth, he was about 40 years old, it was on the left side, and it was his wisdom tooth. And it's like, man, all this time we didn't know any of that stuff when we were just visiting stuff. There are ways to find out, but we didn't.
I'm going to answer that.
Yeah. Do we?
We're not done with this one. No, really, this is really kind of the first stage of the physical production of this. We have these books up here, which we produced for this exhibition, but also as a kind of way of honing the different ideas and bringing them all together. This, you know, we started this project a long time ago. We in effect worked on it for collectively for about a year, and then we kind of broke up into smaller groups and started doing more work. But really, it's been in the last year that we've been starting producing the actual objects that go along with the narratives that have been written. There's nothing in this show that has to do with Mount Tehama, the volcano that no longer exists. So that's an important piece of this project that we need to continue. I'd estimate that what is on display here is around 50% of the physical objects that we will likely produce, and about 75 to 80% of the written things that are going to be produced here. So we will have an exhibition next fall in Chico that will hopefully be kind of the biggest sort of culminating thing. And there's a long-term goal to have this work exist and go to regional museums and hopefully produce a book publication out of it. So there's still a whole lot of work left to be done on this. So we have not talked about starting anything new. I have been doing not projects like this, but not of this degree of complexity with this many people for quite a long time, and I've learned that they tend to take three or four times longer than you think they will. And most of what I have done lately has taken at least a decade to come to fruition. I'm kind of ready myself to wrap up a big project and not take on a really massive one for a while. That's what I say, but that's not what's going to happen. Yeah. So, yeah.
And what are those books then?
Each of these books address different aspects of the project. So this one has to do with the mammoth's molar in the ditch. This one has to do with Ishii. This is an epilogue which contains a kind of epic poem that Heather wrote that weaves together so many of the ideas and themes. There's the giant book of the Hooker Oak in the exhibition. There's a little tiny book of tooth drawings. We'll yet produce one, I'm sure, of Mount Tehama. Am I forgetting anything?
There's the acorn book.
There's the acorn book, and Oliver and I are going to produce even more books specifically about visualizing certain kinds of things. Mm-hmm.
Cool.
Yeah.
Michelle has a question.
So I had a question about the volcano, because it was in the text, but then you're looking around the gallery, and there's no volcano. So could you tell me a little bit about its absence, or why you kept it in the project when it's absent?
Well, interestingly, it's one of the first parts of the project that I completed most of the photography for. I showed you that photograph of Made in Lassen, and the visual approach was very similar to what you saw with Ishii, that is the historic pictures and the contemporary pictures combined. What really got me into that was I found those sites, I made those pictures, and then I learned after the fact that where I was making those photographs was at the very center of what used to be a volcano. And just that mental image of my standing in the center core of what used to be a volcano became very interesting to me, and that's how Rachel Teasdale got involved, a geologist. But in some ways that work isn't, the visual physical work isn't done because I have not quite cracked the nut of how to simultaneously show the historic photographs and the contemporary photographs in relation to the absence of a giant volcano. I know what I'm gonna do, but I haven't done it yet. And for practical purposes, we knew that we just couldn't fit everything into the show here. So we just decided, you know, to wait until that was figured out. But I see it as it's like a four-legged table, and right now we only have three. And so it isn't quite what it's gonna be.
Can you explain the placement of the sculptures on the wall?
I'll try.
All right.
I was similar to the acorns in a way, wondering about information and visualizing information. And very simply, I started to do sort of like a dot plot map of a mammoth seen in section again, but a dot, let's say, for the tip of the nose, trunk, thank you, and then two for the ears, moving on back. So a compressed dot map of what the mammoth would look like, frontal view, and that's about 5 feet wide by about 12 feet high. And then looking down at the mammoth, also a dot map of an aerial view. And I was wondering what would that look like superimposed one over another. And so you could simultaneously see an aerial view and a frontal view of that animal. And I wanted so badly to discover like a mysterious mandala that would come out of that. So I kind of pushed that a little bit. And it's not really a map that's meant to be read per se, but those are points. And I used the objects that we found in the ditch as the markers for the points. And so in some cases, I would take a mold of the thing that I found in the ditch so I could duplicate it several times on that map. And in some cases, I did like a burnout of the actual material and translate into bronze or aluminum. And in other cases, I enhanced what was not there. So, mammoth enhancement.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. You've been waiting. He's been waiting forever. Oh.
No, it was. Oh, yeah. Oh, Susan. And
I'm struck by the. This whole project in terms of things that are vanishing, and I'm wondering, I keep thinking about the impermanence of our life here on Earth, and so you're making something that's more permanent of things that have vanished. So it's almost like you're trying to remind us, I guess, I don't understand the point, I guess, of the project.
No, you're doing.
Yeah, well, yeah, it's almost like, so has it helped you each personally deal with loss and the impermanence of life and things that are vanishing? What is it to remind us? Is it to, I keep thinking about all the cemeteries in our world that have, you know, the commemoration of people that are gone. And is this kind of the same thing that you're doing for all of us?
I'm going to take a crack at that.
Sure, please.
Sometimes we're asked, well, this project started with 7 different topics, which I think now is completely insane. But sometimes we're asked, you know, why these 4 things? What do they have to do with one another? And you could frame it in one way and say they have nothing to do with each other and they have everything to do with each other. You know, what's the point of the project? I think for me in particular, this way of working involves being engaged in a kind of investigation based on curiosity and discovery. And the meaning of that comes about through the act of doing it. It isn't necessarily that there is something specific about Ishi that I need to know that's going to change my life or somebody else's life. But the act of trying to learn more about Ishi changes my relationship to the world. And so it's really more a way of thinking and navigating life. And it's more about a process than a product. I think one of the challenges for us as artists, writers, is how to make physical and accessible the kind of experiences that we have in asking those kinds of questions. And it's not an easy thing to do. It's not an easy thing to transform the experience of investigation into something that's physical, that becomes a touchstone for what it was we did. To be honest, I would do this whether people were interested in it or not. It doesn't make me rich, but it makes me happy. And so, in a selfish way, I do it because I love it.
We can take maybe one more question and then wrap it. Was somebody waiting? You could just.
Cool. As an artist myself and working on open-ended projects that might seem pretty big and kind of like unimaginable what the final product is going to be, I definitely feel the pain of not knowing what I'm going to do and maybe feeling like I'm crazy and getting into something way bigger than I should. Do you guys have any moments where you were really like pushed through those times, and if so, like what pushed you through?
I'll just say something real quickly. I have been doing this kind of investigation long enough to realize that I just love doing the work, and that it always takes me someplace interesting, always. And so, to go back to the topic of why these four things, it didn't matter. We could have picked up a rock and said, what's the story with this rock? And given enough time and enough asking enough questions, I'm sure we could have ended up someplace interesting. I'm speaking for myself. I enjoy doing the work enough that I'm not worried about where it's going to lead me. It always ends up being interesting.
I think that part of any art, so the arts, including writing, is living in a place where you don't know where things are going. And I think that's why people who aren't involved in the arts are really scared of the arts, because it has a certain kind of velocity and a certain kind of unpredictability, and that is, you know, it's uncomfortable to live in that place and not know what you're doing. And that's pretty much what I feel like every day as a writer. In particular, this project has been like that because, you know, for me, I really wanted to work on the mammoth, but I'm not a technical writer. In fact, I realized I hadn't written an essay myself since college. I teach composition, so please don't tell my students this. But I realized, you know, I have to write an essay, and I felt like Charlie Brown, you know, when he sits down and he has to write that summer vacation essay every year, and he's like, you know, counting the words, like 6, 7, you know. Because it was such a difficult thing to do, because I was having to learn the subject of the mammoth, which is a mammoth subject in so many ways. It touches on archaeology, paleontology, there's a lot of material about cloning, there's a lot of tie-ins to different cultures and different indigenous beliefs about who the mammoth was, and you know, there are many cultures currently in Siberia that believe that the mammoth is still with us and that it lives directly beneath the surface of the earth, and that once in a while they're banished from the underworld, and those are the pieces that we find. And trying to understand that and assimilate that with people who are trying to clone the mammoth and people who are having conversations about, you know, whether or not we should create parks where the mammoth could roam if we did clone them, was a lot of different materials, and it was like opening just this never-ending box, and then the little box inside of it, and the little box inside of it. But that's what being an artist is, really, and it's so exciting, along with terror.
Heather just said a lot of what I wanted to say. But I think when I think about what it's like to be an artist and doing that kind of work, I think back to what I said a little while ago about why did I say yes when Byron proposed this to me, and it was so vague, and you know, what was it about? I don't know. But that's why I said yes, right? Because I didn't know. Maybe this gets too to the question of what is the point? You know, this work. I didn't know what the point was, but I knew that what I wanted to do, which was I wanted to think about these things. You know, I wanted to think about photographs and what they mean and what they are, and why it is we think of photographs as permanent in a way that other things are, when in fact they're not permanent, but what does permanence mean anyway? I wanted to think about time and how time works, right, and how time and art, photography and many arts relate to each other. And so I knew I wanted to think about these things, and I didn't know what I'd end up thinking about them, because you have to go through the process, right, to get there to find out. And probably if there was a project where I knew right at the beginning what the point was, in the sense that I knew what I'd think at the end, I probably wouldn't do it, right? Why would I bother? I already know where it's going. That's kind of boring. Now, of course, as an artist, you often have to lie about that, right? Because sometimes you have to, like, fill out a grant proposal or something, and they say, well, what's going to happen at the end of it, right? Where are you going to get to? And the true answer would be, I have no idea, right? That's the only interesting answer for an artist. But you have to lie, you won't get the money, right? So, you know, as artists, we all have to lie about this sometimes. But the truth is, I think, when we're really doing art, we don't know where it's going, right? It's this exploratory process, and that's what's really exciting about it.
And I guess I'd say as a teacher, what I say to my students is that art begets art. And if you're trying really hard to make what looks like art, you're going to shoot yourself in the foot. And those are the first 30, 40 ideas you have, are the things that are at the top of your brain, and they're easy, you know. And you get all excited when you have those ideas. Go, yay! I got it. I'm done. I don't have to struggle. And as you go, just make everything. Just keep going and really make the stuff that comes to mind and that you feel at the moment. And you'll slowly, you know, drill down to a really cool place. It doesn't look anything like you thought it was going to be.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks for your question. I like that.
Yes.
So we'll release now back to the gallery, but we'll be milling around for another 30 minutes, so I encourage you to spend some time with the books and find these people and pick their brains while they are here. We are going to have some readings in the coming weeks of some of the content here, so make sure you're on our mailing list or on Facebook. We'll be announcing those. Thank you guys for being here.
I'm going to look at it. And I'm going to ask different roads.